This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic. In this video, I'm just going to go over some very basics of what vectors and scalars are. They're often in higher level mathematics courses and in physics. But I'm going to try to go over it so somebody with not too much of a mathematical background might at least get an idea of what a vector and a scalar is and how we could work with them. All right, so first of all, a scalar has a magnitude. All right, now a lot of times people think of scalars as real numbers, for instance, 8, square root of 2, pi, 3/4, etc. Or speeds, like 10 miles an hour, 2 kilometers per second. Or a length, like 4 centimeters or 6 inches, etc. But basically it has some sort of magnitude, some sort of number associated with it. It's basically a number, but there might be a little bit to it, because like in a speed or a rate, it's 10 of something, you know, 10 miles per hour. Or 6 what? 6 inches, okay? And often it's just simply a number, like 3/4, right? That's the abstract way of thinking about it. Now a vector, that has a magnitude, so in a certain way it seems like it's a scalar, but it also has a direction, and that makes it very different. Now often vectors are represented with arrows. For instance, you might have an arrow pointing that direction, or an arrow pointing this direction, or an arrow pointing this direction. And notice these have a certain length. Now I haven't said how many units that is, but we could decide how many units that is. Like we could define a unit to be, you know, a certain length. Like let's say from here to here is one unit. So imagine that you could get a ruler there and measure it in some way. You can see these all have, you know, a particular length. Looks to me like they're all a little bit different length, but they're all going a different way as well. So a vector, often when we write it in the plane, like on a piece of paper, we simply draw a little arrow to show the direction and to also show the length. So a vector has a magnitude and direction. It has a certain length and it's going a certain way. One thing that's tricky about vectors is that they are denoted in several different ways. It's not consistent in every book or by every teacher or in every country. I've seen it at least these 5 ways I'm going to show you right here. Let's say you had a vector V. In textbooks, it's usually a bold letter. Okay, so you saw it's sort of like thick like this. Or sometimes they'll put just a little line segment above it, or they'll put an arrow above it, or they'll put a half arrow. See how it's like both sides of the arrow? Or you might just underline the V. So that's at least 5 ways I've seen people write a vector. And so you sort of have to know what context you're working in and to know the notation that's being used when you're doing it. I think what I'm going to do is put a little arrow over it. So I'm going to use this notation. That's what I'm mostly familiar with. So let's say I want to draw a vector V. Okay, often U and V are used for vectors. And I'm going to just draw a vector, and you know, it's like an arrow someplace. It's going to have a length and a magnitude, and a magnitude and direction. And I'm going to show it on a graph, so it's easier to see how long it is, etc. So let's just say I have this vector here. Imagine this vector there. So as you can see, it's 2 units and it's going straight to the right. It's a horizontal vector. But I could have this vector here and I could call that V. These are really all the same. It doesn't matter where they are. If they have exactly the same direction and the same length, it really doesn't matter where you put it in the plane. So I could go over here if this is really 2 units long, and I could say That's vector v. I say these are really all the same vector. Okay, so it doesn't matter where you happen to place it in the plane. So we're not talking about congruence. We're really just saying that's exactly the same vector. So this vector v is 2 units long, right? And it's going to the right. And so I think of the right as going east, okay? So it's going directly. The direction, in this case, happens to be directly east. Usually we don't talk about it in terms of east and west, etc., because it's hard to tell exactly just by stating that. For instance, if I have something like that, you know, I say, well, it's kind of going northeast, but how much northeast? So we'll be using other terms instead of just north and east, etc. All right, let's look at another vector v. Notice this one's different. These are all the same. They all are pointing in exactly the same direction. You can see that direction happens to be almost north, but it's also going a little west, etc. But it does have a certain direction, and its length is all the same. Now, if you want to check out the beginning of the vector where the arrow is not, right? So we call this the beginning, and there's the endpoint of the vector. Notice how far to the left or right would you have to go, and then how far up or down would you have to go to get at this endpoint here? Okay, so if we look at this one right here, I'm going to the left one space and I'm going up 3. Look at this one. It's at the origin, I'm going to the left one space and up 3. Look at this one over here all the way to the left, I'm going one left, one space to the left, and 3 spaces up. And in fact, that's how this one is here also. This is really 1 unit and that's 3 units. Okay, so if you had this starting point, we call that the initial point of the vector, and we have the ending point here, the terminal point of the vector, you see you would have to go to the left one space and then up 3 spaces. So the length is actually 1 here, but if a way of describing a vector is to use these symbols, now it sort of looks like a less than symbol and a greater than symbol. All right, and so what you do is you put how far you'd have to go from your starting point to get to your endpoint. First, you put the number you have to go left or right. Now, if you're going to the left, it's negative, so you'd have to go 1 to the left, okay, and then I would have to go up 3 spaces, so I'd have to go up 3 spaces, and you have the same, you know, look right here at the end. It looks like this. That is how we write a vector. So vector B could be written like this, and it kind of tells you what it looks like. Okay? Because remember, it doesn't matter where on the plane it is. All right? It's just easier sometimes if you're looking at this. Now here's an interesting thing. If you look at this one right here, I'm going to change it. Let's see. I can make that green maybe. Okay, so you look at this one right here. Look at the green one. Notice that its starting point right here is at 0, 0. So it's at the origin. And it ends at the ordered pair. What's that ordered pair? Negative 1, 3. Well, right when we write ordered pairs, we use parentheses, right? And we've got the x-coordinate and the y-coordinate. So this over here, where I write the vector, notice it's not in parentheses. Okay, but it corresponds to where the endpoint would be is if you put the starting point at the origin. So if you took a vector, you started at the origin, and you went negative 1 and up 3, okay, you would get that vector, v, that we're talking about, and then those numbers look exactly the same as the numbers that are in the ordered pair, the negative 1, 3, negative 1, 3. And these numbers here are called the components of the vector. And by the way, you could have vectors, you could have 3 space, in other words, 3 dimensions, but we're only going to be talking about 2 dimensions, for now at least. So This just gives you a basic idea about what a vector is. And some people think of vectors as forces, right? That would be like if you're taking a physics class, or the direction the wind is going and how fast it's going. Those are some ideas that you use vectors for. But this is just the very basics, and then we're going to go on to another video where we'll be doing a little bit more with it, and we'll eventually get to what scalars have to do with all of this. But for now, the scalar is really just like a number, and it doesn't have any direction. Okay, so for instance, the length of the vector here could be thought of as a number, and I bet you could figure out the length. Let's say if this is 1 and this is 3, could you figure out the length of that vector here? Okay, I'm kind of blowing this up, so this is magnified now, right? This is a magnified, oops, can't spell view right. Magnified view of this vector v, which was negative 1, 3, right? That's how you denote that vector. And so the question is, here's the vector. Could you figure out the length of that vector? Later we'll decide, talk about, maybe not my videos, but when you're in advanced courses, et cetera, or even in trig, you can figure out this angle here. Okay? But with some just basic algebra and the Pythagorean theorem, you should be able to figure out the length here. Sort of like a squared plus b squared equals c squared. So hopefully you know that. 3 squared plus 1 squared equals that hypotenuse squared. So we have 9 plus 1, 10 is c squared. So the length of this vector right here happens to be the square root of 10. Okay, so if you're given the components, you could actually figure out the length of that vector as well. So that's just a little bit of extra information, and we'll be doing some more problems about adding vectors, multiplying with scalars, finding out the length of vectors, which I did right here in later videos. This is your math gal, Julie Harland. Please visit my website at yourmathgal.com, where all of my videos are organized by topic.